Grace, peace, and mercy be unto you from the triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. The text for this morning's sermon comes from our epistle reading from 1 Corinthians, the last part, 24 through 27, which says, "Do you not know that in a race all the runners compete, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air. I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified." So as this morning we're going to have the rite of First Communion for 9 of our young people who have not yet been confirmed. First, just to answer a question that I've already gotten several times, this is not something new. In fact, it's the way it used to be, but it was not in the church setting. It was in the home setting. Those of you that remember your teachings from the catechism, and probably your pastor told you that Martin Luther wrote the catechism so that the parents could teach their children. When the Lutherans came to this country, it was a common event as the families would grow in their relationship to Christ. They would teach their children, and every so often, once a month or whatever, the circuit rider, literally the circuit rider, a pastor, would mount his horse and ride from home to home within that circuit, and he would visit with the family, and he would check on the instruction of the children. The children that were ready, he would question, and he would commune them. When they were ready, he would question them and confirm them. We have moved away from this practice mainly for convenience. It's not convenient anymore for the pastor to visit homes, and so we ask that the children come to churches. We split time with them in confirmation classes. We teach them. Not every pastor does First Communion. I do, and as I tell the parents, for two reasons. Number one, it's a gift from God. Now, I don't know about you, but I would never, as a parent, stick a gift under the Christmas tree and tell my children, if you're good for 3 years, you get the gift. It would not go unopened because something would happen. The second is it's a gift for us to, as you heard me tell them, and you know, it's Jesus becomes part of us, we become part of Jesus, because we live in a world that's full of trials and tribulations and full of sin. And I know of no group right now in our society other than our children that need all the help that God can give them. Because they face things that you and I did not even dream possible when we were growing up. I didn't know about abortion until I was an adult. Taking the lives of elderly at Wanton is now becoming an issue throughout Europe and will soon become an issue here in this country. Something, again, that we've never heard of or thought of. And now we have artificial intelligence. The debate rages on about, are they humans or are they not? Do they deserve the rights of humans? Do they have a soul? Throw into that creation versus evolution and a whole bunch of other things, along with the significant rise in suicide and a significant rise in certain drugs. Our children need all the help they can. And so as it says in this part of Corinthians, Paul is talking to the Corinthians, and you know the story about him using the analogy of the race, the runner running the race. It's all about persevering and running the race in order to obtain the prize, and the prize is Christ. It's not the things in this world. And it talks about exercising self-control. So the question for you this morning, are you exercising self-control? And the answer is going to be yes. You are to some degree, whether it's within God's parameters or your own, you're exercising some self-control. You make some decisions on what to say and what to do. Bigger question, are you exercising self-control according to God's will? That's a different story. But these young people need the help that they can get to exercise control in their environment, in their lives, according to God. Starting this morning, they will have one more tool at their disposal, one more means of grace that they can use to deal with the many trials and tribulations they're going to face, to help them exercise that self-control. Because we, as adults, we remember what it was like to be a child. If you don't, I do. There was not a whole lot of self-control. My parents taught me self-control. And it's no different with the children of today. It's not that they are bad children, it's just that we live in a world that offers a lot of choices. And our world and our society is confusing our young people, along with adults, that certain things that we've taught for years as being wrong are now okay. And it's a struggle. And so they need to exercise, just as we do, self-control according to God's will. And Holy Communion is one of those ways in which we continue to be brought back to the foot of the cross, brought back to the promises of Christ, that he lived, he suffered, he died, and he rose again for each and every one of us individually. It doesn't matter if we're 2 months old or 162 years old, it's for all of us. So we need to exercise that self-control. Christ did. He's our perfect example. He came into this world. He didn't have to. He came into the world. At any point from the time he was born until the time he rose again, he could have used his divine powers to deal with any situation he had. But you will notice as you read the scriptures, he did not. He did some miracles. But he did not exercise his powers for his own self. In other words, to help himself or to bring power and glory to himself. He used them when he did in his ministry, age 30 or so, 33. But in every case that he used them and gave the credit to God the Father. He always pointed people to the Father. It was never about him. He used self-control. God's self-control. And our children learn this, you learn this when you read God's word and when you worship and when you take Holy Communion and when you do the things that you do by the work of the Holy Spirit in you. Shocking news for some people is that we have no good in us to begin with. We're sinners. And it's because of our stop refusing the gift that God gives us the gift of faith, and through that faith we begin to grow in our relationship to God. So these 9 young people have started confirmation classes. They've been going since September. And now we've added the First Communion classes they've had and taken. And now we'll have that signified this morning by actually taking First Communion. We need to exercise self-control. But it's not our self-control, it's God's self-control. Use God's means that he gives us to do this. And if Jesus does it, then it's an example for us, as I said, and we should follow his example. My heart goes out to our children, as I said, because I know some of the things they're facing. I talk to them. They give questions about things that they're encountering in their world. Some of them are shocking. But all you have to do is look around us and know that we need the care and the gifts, love and the compassion and the healing and the strength that only Jesus can give us. So we as adults celebrate when we take communion. We look forward to that opportunity to have our sins washed away one more time, for an opportunity to be close and personal with our Savior one more time. And it helps us through the week or until whatever time we come back. And so again, reason for our children to do the very same. Your children needed clothes, you would not deny them. If they needed food, you would not deny them. So we don't deny them the gifts that God promises for us. The church has a huge task in front of it to minister to our children as well as everyone else. So my prayer, the church's prayer, is that as these young people continue to grow, as they continue to read God's word, as they continue to worship, continue to commune with the Savior that has redeemed them, my prayer is that they will continue to receive the strength and the healing and the things that they need, just as you and I do. And I would also challenge you as parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, sponsors, and members of the church to continue to encourage our young people to make use of the gifts that we've been given, to use them rightly, as they struggle in their life, just as you use them in the struggles in your lives. So God will bless these children as they continue to grow. He will bless his church until he returns. My prayer is that we as a congregation, as a church body, continue to proclaim the gospel message, exercise the self-control that God has given us, and go into a world that desperately needs to hear the gospel and allow people not only to hear it, but to see it at work, to see it at work through not only us, but our young people as well. Now may the grace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, guard your hearts and your minds through your faith in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.